at Whitworth, say that 10 times fast, she served as the chair of her campus's chapter of Young Americans for Freedom. During her time as chair, she organized a discussion panel about gun rights and legislation featuring liberal and conservative professors and the county sheriff. She pioneered the 9/11 Never Forget Project at the school and a 9/11 memorial service and hosted New York Times best-selling author and YAF alumnus Jason Matera. Whitworth's YAF chapter grew vastly under her leadership as more students joined the club and became emboldened to push back against the liberal bias at their school. In fact, we have a few of them with us at this program. And Madison is passionate about conservatism and preserving Ronald Reagan's ideas and values and relishes in the incredible opportunity to share the Reagan Ranch with students and YAF supporters. Please welcome Madison.
Thank you, Jolie. It's my pleasure to introduce our luncheon speaker this afternoon. Dr. Jake Jacobs has degrees in American history and biblical and Judeo-Christian studies from Arizona State University, Ashland Theological Seminary, and Northwest University. He has spent more than 30 years serving in the public and private high school systems and teaching at the college level about his passion for our constitutional republic under God, all while stressing historical correctness in the face of politically correct intimidation by the academic establishment. When Dr. Jacobs was a public high school teacher, he publicly defended Wisconsin Governor Scott Walker on Fox and Friends. Dr. Jacobs is a frequently requested speaker for Young Americans for Freedom, a regular guest on conservative radio, and very popular at Tea Party, civic, and church events. He is a dynamic and energizing speaker, writer, and historian who not only captivates audiences, but inspires them to action. Dr. Jacobs is the president and founder of Politically Incorrect Institution, the host of Freedom Project Academy's One Nation, and the author of three books, The Gospel, God's Law and Government, Mobocracy, The Cultural and Political War to Destroy Our Republic Under God, and Mother, Should I Trust the Government? He has been married for 32 years to his lovely wife, Lori, and has two children, Joseph and Anastasia. When he's not writing, teaching, or speaking, he loves watching the Green Bay Packers and enjoys his backyard fire pit at night. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Jake Jacobs.
Thank you, Madison. The capital of Wisconsin, Madison, great founding father. Let me see. President Roosevelt and Franklin Delano Roosevelt, Franklin Delano Roosevelt and Winston Churchill, they met during World War II, August 1941. And they got together on Her Majesty's ship, the Prince of Wales. And on that ship, on August 10th, 1941, they had a Christian service. And in that Christian service, they sang Onward Christian Soldiers. The English chaplain actually read from the book of Yehoshua, where the Lord God speaks to Joshua and says, Kasach ve'amatz, be strong and brave, over and over again in chapter 1 of Joshua. It's not a coincidence that Israelites and even Israelis to that day say Kasach ve'amatz because it's an expression of being strong and brave in your faith, the creator of the universe. And they say that actually Winston Churchill openly cried at this get-together on the Prince of Wales in 1941. FDR and Churchill spoke of the war against National Socialism, Imperial Japan, to preserve and to save Christian civilization. Now, our leaders all throughout World War II, you see this all throughout the newspapers. I'm a geek. I've been saving newspapers forever, and I've inherited quite a few throughout the years. And you'll see, for example, when we invaded France, Normandy, France, June 6, 1944, FDR called for the nation to pray to Almighty God. You see it during the Battle of the Bulge and many of the battles throughout World War II. These great leaders called for prayer to the creator of the universe. Even after World War II, when Winston Churchill came to the United States in the state of Missouri and gave his famous Iron Curtain speech. He spoke within of the evils of Marxism, but talked about the preservation of Christian civilization. Harry S. Truman, a Baptist, by the way, Democrat Harry S. Truman, understanding in 1949 the depths of the evils of socialism, of Marxism, of Soviet socialism, he gave his wonderful inaugural address. I highly recommend reading it. And in that inaugural address, he laid out the evils of atheistic, communistic Marxism. And he said in that speech, in that inaugural address of his, he said, "We believe that all men are created equal because they are created in the image of God." Now, I want you to think of those words. Here is the President of the United States of America reaching into the book of Genesis, chapter 1, verse 26, and saying that man is made in the image of God, the Imago Dei. That was Christian civilization. Fast forward to 1961. Democrat president, Roman Catholic president, John Fitzgerald Kennedy. Shortly thereafter will be the Bay of Pigs and the Cuban Missile Crisis, where the world almost went into a nuclear war. And Kennedy was dealing with the communist, atheistic cosmology that says over and over that the state, the government, is over man and that God doesn't exist. And yet Kennedy, in his wonderful inaugural address, said, "The rights of man come not from the generosity of the state, but from the hand of God Almighty." That is Christian civilization that declares to the world that man is created by God Almighty and set free to pursue life and happiness. In 1961, when the Soviet cosmonaut by the name of Yuri Gagarin, first man in space, goes up there, Nikita Khrushchev used to love to brag and say, "Hey, Yuri Gagarin," he said when he was up there, "there ain't no God up here." Right? And yet, I can still remember it like it was yesterday. My dad telling us we had to turn on the TV because American Christian man, astronaut man, was by the moon. And on Christmas Eve, 1968, it was magical. Those who are baby boomers and older remember that day. Because what did we see for the first time on our televisions? The planet Earth taken from the moon. And what did our astronauts do? Breshit bara Elohim. They read from the book of Genesis, chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And then 7 months later, American astronaut Christian man was on the moon, and the second man on the moon, Buzz Aldrin, who's still alive. What a fighter that guy is. What did he do? He took communion, honoring the Savior and creator of the universe, of the moon, Jesus Christ. That is American Christian civilization. Now today, this is an amazing thing. This is the 30th anniversary of the fall of that evil wall of Marxism. The 30th anniversary. And how many of us gray hairs remember when President Reagan gave that wonderful speech with the Brandenburg Gate behind him, and he said, "Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall." And it came down to the influence of great men like Ronald Reagan. Now, I'm an anniversary kind of guy. I mean, I'm a history geek, so numbers stick in my head, dates stick in my head. We're about to approach the 100th anniversary of when Vladimir Lenin, the so-called father of the communist revolution in Russia, outlawed Christmas on December 25th, outlawed Christmas, or Nikola, and had his Cheka go and kill and attack any Russians that dare to worship Christ on Christmas Day. Now, some of you said this hit it hard. Are you sleeping at the wheel back there? I got a job to do here.
I've been there.
Where's George? Where's George? George, same thing, huh? All right. Hey, look, I'm just a socialist blaming it on somebody else, okay? No, but I think this is fascinating because I think God works in strange and mysterious ways. Think of it. We're coming up at the 100th anniversary of the Soviet socialist outlawing Christmas, and yet many of you remember that on Christmas Day, 1991, what died? The Soviet Union. Yes, Keep that in mind, Christmas time. Now let's think about how Christianity spread across the world. 11 of the 12 apostles were executed for their faith in Christ. Peter was crucified upside down. Paul's head was cut off. Peter's brother Andrew was in Greece talking about Jesus and the good news. And the governor said, no more talking about this. And he says, I cannot do this. I must talk about the glory of Christ. So what did they do? They executed him on a crucifix, as you see in the picture. Thus we see that the flag of Scotland is the St. Andrew cross. And we see this symbolism of Christian civilization all throughout many nations. The symbol of the Christian cross became the symbol of Great Britain. The crosses of St. Andrew, St. George, and St. Patrick. Norway, Sweden, Finland, Switzerland, Slovakia, and many others bear the Christian cross of Christ. And I don't think it's coincidence, by the way, that militant Islam loves to burn not only the American flag, but the flag of Great Britain and the flag of Israel. Those three flags to them, the Judeo-Christian worldview, represents an evil in their eyes. Now, I've taken my students over to Normandy, France, and Anzio, Italy, where almost 20,000 crosses of Christ and stars of David remind us not only of the ultimate sacrifice by Christ at Calvary, but of the ultimate sacrifice of our brave warriors in World War II. So we see that this Christian civilization symbolism permeates all throughout nations of freedom and Western civilization. Not only do we see Christian civilization as the foundation of many nations, but it's the foundation of education. The Hebrew prophets, the apostles, and those after them gave the world a book, the Bible. The holy scriptures of God, Yahweh breathed, to guide us, to tell us his story, and to guide us here on earth. And to understand this book, people needed to read. That may sound elementary, but it was profound because there was a revolution in education. And then many great Christian thinkers created the university. And not only was the university to study the universe, but it was to study the creator of the universe, Jesus. And so they had to learn Hebrew and Greek and Latin, the languages above the cross of Christ. They could understand Moses in Hebrew, Cicero in Latin, Aristotle in Greek. Our founders understood those languages. And if you read our founders, you go into an amazing world of wisdom and insight into a limited republic that we have. It's not by a coincidence. They were deep into the world of Christian civilization. Now, we know that their logos back in the day, from Harvard and Yale and William and Mary and Brown and all the logos, well into the 1880s, 1890s, came from the scriptures, the Bible. They came from the Psalms and Isaiah and many others. The foundation of education in this nation. I mean, even here in ever-growing, sad to say, atheistic California, look at the logo from University of California. It's the scriptures opened up. It's Genesis chapter 1, Yahi Ur, let there be light. And education was predicated on a belief that wisdom and knowledge came from the light of the word, permeated through all other studies in life. By the way, this I'm holding here, this is a Bible that was actually printed by the federal government during World War II, signed by FDR. This is a Catholic version. There were Protestant and Catholic versions that were given to men like my father who fought in the war. Don't tell the ACLU and the Freedom from Religion Foundation, but that's a historical fact. Now, sadly today, oh, by the way, I forget this one too. Whoops. Well, the founder of Young Americans for Freedom, William Buckley, in 1951, wrote the excellent book, God and Man at Yale. And in it, he warned the country of the ever-growing academic affinity towards Marxism, statism, and atheism. He was a prophet in his time. He said that there's an attack within the universities of traditional values in Christian Western civilization. And he understood that when Yale was founded in 1701 as a Christian institution. Look at its logo to this day. Lux et Veritas in Hebrew opened up to the scriptures. But sadly today, university and public schools across our great land have rejected Christian Christian education and civilization. In fact, they've become antagonistic towards it. Their Christian words and models have become empty and hollow. It does not surprise me when leftists today and our college campuses cry out, hey, hey, ho, ho, Western Civ's got to go. And I've been doing research lately and connecting with a couple of YAF students at Loyola Marymount in Los Angeles. And I've been shocked to see that Western Civ courses are rarely, if ever, taught in this country anymore. Rarely, if ever, taught. Western civilization, the foundation is Christianity, is the wonderful values of the sacredness of life, and that life comes ultimately from our Creator, as it says in the Declaration of Independence. This isn't taught much anymore also, that Christianity played a profound role in the American Revolution. I wish we had more time. You guys should just hire me. Make me a teacher here so I could just do this for hours and hours and hours, right? Yeah. But bottom line is it did. In fact, King George III called the American Revolution that damnable Presbyterian rebellion, because the Presbyterians had taught that God was above man and that kings were to be servants unto the people, thus the term prime minister. The word comes right from the scriptures. A political leader is to be a servant unto the people. And the king, of course, hated that. Now, in the Declaration of Independence, it declares to the world, it declares not just to us, but to the world, that life and liberty derives not from the government, but from our Creator. And our Creator is called in the very last paragraph, the Supreme Judge of the World. I know that's not very politically correct and popular today. It's very judgmental, right, to say that God is a judge. But our founders, they moved from that understanding. Because if there is no God, as Dostoevsky says, then everything and anything is permissible. This is why we see such lawlessness in the land, because that belief has permeated throughout our educational systems in America. There will come a day, the scriptures tell us, called Yom Yahweh, the day of the Lord, where the God of Israel will judge the world. Even Thomas Jefferson declared, I tremble for my country when I reflect that God is just and his justice cannot sleep forever. And the great Abraham Lincoln, in his wonderful second inaugural address, which when you study that inaugural address, people, it's so short, but so sublime, so wonderful. He declared that the judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. This is why we love Jesus so much. We've been saved from God's judgment. In June of 1787, at the Constitutional Convention, the oldest gentleman there, Benjamin Franklin, he could sense there were problems on that June day. The big states were fighting the small states, the slave states were fighting the free states, and he rises up to calm down the convention. And I'll paraphrase his words. Gentlemen, don't you remember in 1774, in this very room, we were there with George Washington and Sam Adams and John Adams and Patrick Henry and George Mason. And we were afraid of war with the greatest empire in the world, Great Britain. We prayed. We prayed. We asked God for help, and he heard us. The longer I live, he said, the more I'm convinced that God governs in the affairs of men. And if a sparrow cannot fall to the ground without his notice, can an empire rise without his aid? Young people, old people, God does govern in the affairs of all men and women, not just presidents and prime ministers, but in every one of us here, every molecule and every minute of our existence. Now, we know that prayer, Christianity, and the Bible played an important role in our history. And out of all the books in the world, what are our presidents from George Washington, almost all of our presidents sworn in on? The Word of God. So how is it in 2019 AD, Anno Domini, the year of our Lord, that we've gotten to the point where Christianity, Christ, traditional values, is attacked and frowned upon? We don't have the time, but ultimately, as George would concur with me, you go back into the French Revolution, the Enlightenment time period, when men like Rousseau and Robespierre declared that the Christian worldview was evil, that the Bible was bogus, that Christ was a myth, that the state shall deliver man with his reason, with his mind, to solve the problems. And out of that came the bloody revolution, bloody French Revolution. And those ideas permeated throughout France and throughout Germany and throughout England. And a guy that you all know by the name of Karl Marx came along, and he said, look, I've got the answer.
He declared that atheistic, scientific socialism would destroy what he called capitalism. I call it free enterprise. And he said that we will destroy oppressive capitalism and the Christian family with its drug life belief that God made men and women in his image and that he designed marriage between the two as holy as he is holy. Marx also called for the abolition of private property and for atheistic government to take over all of education. Now, eventually, as many of you know, and George so wonderfully taught earlier, those ideas got into the heads of people like Vladimir Lenin, Leon Trotsky, Joseph Stalin, Pol Pot, Mao Zedong, Ho Chi Minh, Fidel Castro, to name a few. And with the barrel of a gun, through the power of the state, over 100 million were slaughtered by those Marxists, demons on the earth. Now, it's not a coincidence that they destroyed the very thing that we love so much in this nation. If it goes, we're done. The First Amendment. Think of it. Freedom of religion, speech, press, and peaceably to assemble, and the right to petition our government if they've grievously denied our life and liberty. So those Marxist butchers went after freedom of religion, speech, press, and assembly, and the right to petition our government. Look at what's happening at Hong Kong right now as we speak. As China, communist China, Marxist China, persecutes Christian freedom fighters like Joshua Wang and Agnes Chow in the NBA, and they tell the NBA, if you want to make money, then you shut your mouth. Shame on the NBA. Freedom is much more important. Now, eventually, a few smart communist thinkers realized they couldn't destroy nations like our republic under God or like the United Kingdom. They couldn't fool men like my father, who went in at 17 years old in 1943 and came home early in 1946. My dad was a Christian and believed in God, and he wouldn't be fooled by those Marxist fools. So they couldn't fool him on the outside, but they figured we can fool him on the inside. So these Marxist thinkers said, we'll get them in the three C's, the culture, the churches, and the classroom. Now, many of these left-wing, radical, atheistic thinkers left Europe in the 30s, and where did they come to? The United States of America. From Brandeis to University of Wisconsin-Madison to right here in California at Berkeley. They taught in our universities, and they taught our future teachers and the teachers who were the teachers after them. They taught them scientific socialism, Marxism, leftism, and atheism. They taught how evil free enterprise was, along with Christ and Christianity. And what the amazing hypocritical thing is they had incredible freedom and prosperity to teach these things freely, as they said that we were evil. And one of the leaders of this group, a radical, I think he's emeritus still at Columbia University, his name is Todd Gitlin. He once declared, you know, we lost the politics of the 60s. Reagan became governor of California. Nixon became president. We lost politics of the conservatives and the Christians. But I'll tell you what we did win, the textbooks. The textbooks. I used to be in public schools until I defended Governor Walker. That's a long story, and now at a private Catholic school. But when I first started teaching in the 80s and I saw what the public textbooks were like, I was absolutely appalled. The bastardization of true historical context and Christianity has become the enemy in the textbooks. And it's a shame. Since the 1960s, education has been more and more permeated with an anti-Christian worldview, determined through political correctness, thought police, and indoctrination, what has become known as repressive tolerance. It was popular in the 60s for students at college campuses to yell out this chant, Marx, Mao, and Marcuse. Marx, Mao, and Marcuse. Now, Marcuse was one of these hardcore lefty Marxists from Germany, came here and complained that we were an evil country. He actually was at University of California, San Diego, when I was living in San Diego back in the 70s. He was a rock star on college campuses in the 60s. I guess you could kind of say, even though he was older, he was like the Ben Shapiro of the left. All right. I mean, literally, this guy was something else. The kids would just flock to him, and it was like it was an atheist Jesus Christ speaking. And he talked about how bad America was, Christ and Christianity, and he had a concept called repressively tolerant. Now, I know that sounds contradictory and intolerant because it is. Marcuse and many teachers like him said, forget about pluralism. Forget about a belief that in a free society is open to exchange of many competing ideas in the marketplace of ideas, the university. The university should only allow one side to be taught, one side to be heard. In fact, it should go beyond the university all the way down to kindergarten. This is repressive tolerance. We should only teach and accept ideas we like, we agree with. We must reject and fight. We must destroy all ideas and philosophies that we disagree with. And by now, I think many of you, if not all of you, know, yes, what are those ideas? Christ, Christianity, traditionalism, the Christian family as taught in the scriptures. They taught that America is essentially bad, pro-life is bad, the Bible, the scriptures is bad, Christian education is bad. But they went beyond that in a world of relativism that rejects the reality of a truth above man. They began to say, if anything goes, if it feels good. As Ben Shapiro always says, my facts don't give a rat's patootie about your feelings, right? I had to clean that one up, you never know. And how I feel became the new truth. Truth no longer belongs ultimately to God, the way and the truth and the life. Truth becomes my truth, your truth. It's my creation predicated upon feelings, not facts. Repressive tolerance of the 60s has created the bizarre, untruthful, and profoundly intolerant world of today. In August of 1963, Reverend Martin Luther King gave his wonderful I Have a Dream speech. Wonderful I Have a Dream speech. And in that speech, he quotes the scriptures all over the place. And he calls the words of the Declaration of Independence magnificent. Why haven't we heard those words so often, and very few times, we don't hear those words anymore. Young Americans for Freedom is dedicated to that understanding for young people that the words of the Declaration, that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and a pursuit of happiness, are magnificent and must be fought for till our last breath. Martin Luther King's dream was a dream of equality married to liberty. Martin Luther King understood the greatness of America in 1,000 different ways, and yet he understood that this nation was to reach more magnificent heights. It needed to break the chains of oppression that went back before the Civil War. We've done that in America as Jim Crow and institutionalized racism has been destroyed in the land. However, as repressive tolerance and identity politics permeates many of our schools, it creates what I call the Colin Kaepernicking of America. I don't think he's very popular here. Now, I think many of you know the story of Colin, taking the knee during the national anthem, protesting that America is primarily, essentially, a very bad nation. He's stuck in the Jim Crow days, and that our nation has no magnificent qualities. Kaepernick, like many in the hardcore, if they disagree with us, what are we called? Fascists, Nazis, racists. If I had a dollar for every time I've been called a fascist in my academic career and going back to my days at Arizona State, I'd be rich. I'd have a nice little villa out here in the ocean. Seriously, it is so fashionable today to call us fascists because we believe in life, because we believe in the Constitution of the United States of America. Now, Colin's story is sadly the story of what's gone wrong in education. Colin Kaepernick was born in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. He was raised not too far away from my home until the age of 4. He was adopted by white parents with white siblings. His grandparents, white grandparents, not too far away from where I live. Friends of mine know them, say they're wonderful people. He even loved Brett Favre, the quarterback of the Packers back in the 90s. So what happened to Colin? He moved to California. I love the state. Don't pick on me. I'm just saying. The family moved to California. And eventually he got drafted by the San Francisco 49ers, and San Francisco values got into his head. And then he decided to take some courses at UC Berkeley. You know the rest of the story. Because there he began to take professors who taught him Marxist critical race theory, a bogus theory where the white race is declared the perpetual perpetrator of oppression, where the words and vision of Martin Luther King and those of us here are ridiculed. Kaepernick now proudly wears T-shirts. Well, it's on there, yep. T-shirts of communist dictators like Fidel Castro and socks depicting the police as pigs. Kaepernick, he's a micro example of the macro problem that's plaguing anti-Christian, anti-conservative universities today. And ironically, just like Herbert Marcuse, Kaepernick and hardcore leftists decry us, America, as an evil nation, while yet literally hundreds of thousands of people from around the world are coming where to be free? The United States of America. Have they no shame? We're such a giving nation, such a good people. Two stories come to mind about our great republic. I used to teach a University of Wisconsin American Government course at the academy where I teach. My supervising professor, I was going to interview with him, and I didn't know, but one of my students from the public school where I used to teach sent this professor some YouTube teachings of mine. That went over like a lead balloon. So I was ready when the professor was ready to grill me, but he grilled my syllabus, and in the syllabus he said, Jake, you got to stop calling this republic under God. You can't do that. And I said, well, look, my PhD dissertation is on the founding fathers and relationship between the biblical worldview. I mean, seriously, you know. And so I sent him from the largest library in the world, the Library of Congress, a bunch of links just destroying his argument. He never responded to that one. But the other one that really got me is he said this. He goes, look, you should stop calling the founding fathers. And I'm going to quote him. He says, he said to me, I wasn't there. They ain't my daddy. Okay? Well, guys, I know I look older. I even got my senior citizen discount last night at the movie Midway, okay? But I was there. In fact, if I was there with Sam Adams drinking some of that good beer, okay? So I told him I was there. The founding fathers were my daddy, and I was there. How many of you guys have seen the great movie, It's a Wonderful Life? Raise your hand. Okay. Ah, wonderful. If you haven't, raise your hand if you haven't. You call yourself an American? I'm sorry. What? Between now and Christmas, you've got to watch it.
We'll see.
All right? All right.
I like Elf.
Oh, that's not even close. Okay. Now, this movie was done by a dear friend of Ronald Reagan's, Frank Capra. Capra was not American by birth or blood. He tells the story that when his impoverished Sicilian family moved to America in 1903, and they were in the New York Harbor, and they saw the Statue of Liberty, his father, Salvatore Capra, full of excitement and enthusiasm, yells out to his six-year-old son, Francesco Checo, look at the light of Lady Liberty. That is the greatest light since the star over Bethlehem. That is the light of freedom. Never forget that freedom. Capra never did. He became a naturalized citizen, not through blood, but through his heart and through the law. Capra filled his movies with the love of America's greatness, exceptionalness, and the moral principles that can be shared by all as legal citizens of the United States of America. Now let's consider his other classic film, Mr. Smith Goes to Washington. How many have seen that one? Oh, this is a good bunch. This is a piece of cake talking instead of talking to lefties. So this movie was released 1 month after the beginning of World War II. The Nazis outlawed the film. But the French said the Nazis will be occupying us in about 30 days. So they had 30 days of showing the film, and one Parisian theater showed the film nonstop for 30 days. The theater was packed. Now I ask this question, why? It's an American film. Because the film was dealing with the corruption of government in Washington, D.C. Nothing new under the sun, right? Mr. Smith, like Abraham Lincoln, who Capra adored, is dedicated to the proposition that America is to be of and by and for the people. So while Mr. Smith Goes to Washington has become truly an American classic, at that time it had a universal appeal that resounded with the love of individual liberty versus the corruption of the state and collectivism of and by and for the government. In 1939, the French people, in the midst of dealing with the tyranny of National Socialism, dreamed the dream of Mr. Smith's love of liberty. When the French created the Statue of Liberty in the 1880s, she was originally called Liberty Enlightening the World. Liberty Enlightening the World. You're fired. No, I'm kidding. Okay. You'll notice at the feet are broken chains, broken government shackles and chains of her feet, symbolizing the sacrifice of the people, black, white, and brown, and all colors in between, to destroy the tyranny of government slavery. So while Colin Kaepernick and hardcore leftists absurdly declare that racism is a part of our DNA, whatever the hell that means, that it's passed on, and they create bogus narratives of white privilege and white guilt by birth and pigmentation politics by party, they defy the reality and sacrifice of those great freedom fighters throughout our history, regardless of color. Those men and women were dedicated to the proposition that all were created equal and endowed by our Creator with the right to life and liberty. They were with our founders in 1776. When those six Marines raised that flag in Iwo Jima, February of 1945, and three of those men never came home to their mothers. They were with our founders in 1776. When our GIs died in the blood-soaked snow of the Battle of the Bulge in December of 1944, they were with our founders in 1776. When the first African-American black recipient of the Congressional Medal of Honor, William Kearny, at the 1863 Civil War battle at Fort Wagner, grabbed Old Glory, and before she could touch the ground, said, "Gentlemen, I've saved Old Glory. 5 bullets in him." That man was with our founders in 1776. When the black American Tuskegee Airmen shot down Nazi planes over Europe, they were with our founders in 1776. When the most decorated GI during World War II, the Japanese Americans, the Nisei, helped destroy Japanese oppression, they were with our founders in 1776. When my papa, GI Joe Jacobs, on that PBY Catalina in 1945, helped stop Japanese terror in the Pacific, he was with our founders in 1776. And I ask this question, and it's not stressed enough in our schools. Who fought for and died for the 13th Amendment to end slavery in this nation? Who fought for the 1868 14th Civil Rights Amendment that declares, "Nor shall any state deprive any person of life, liberty, or property without due process"? Who fought for the 1870 15th Amendment for voting? The 1957, 1960, 64, 65 Civil Rights and Voting Rights Amendments to end evil Jim Crow? Dare I say, Americans of all colors and heritages, African, European, independents, Republicans, and Democrats who finally had the courage to stop the tyranny of their party. I dare say it because it is truth and it needs to be taught to our youth. In closing, believe it or not, I'm winding down. Unless, Jolie, I got an hour. No, I'm just kidding. All right. Last night, I went to the movie Midway, right over here in State Street. I remember when I went to the movie Pearl Harbor, I took my papa's Navy top. I have it framed now in a container of it back at home in my office. And it made me miss my father. More importantly, it made me recognize and realize that there was a battle for Christian civilization back then, and it wasn't so long ago. And there's a battle for Christian civilization in our republic under God today. So I want to show you a short clip of a gentleman by the name of, a 23-year-old gentleman by the name of Lois Dean. And he fought in the 1944 Battle of Manila Bay, and then I'll close. Do I have to move it or? Okay. I think the volume starts quite soon. Yeah, here we go. Thank you. I see that picture at the end, it just makes me think that my dad was out there at the time. They went about their business. They went about their business. When those U.S. Navy pilots on June 4th, 1944, at the Battle of Midway, knowing that they were probably going to die, like, who can understand that kind of courage? As they attacked the Japanese Armada, and when Lois Dean fought on November 5th, 1944, at the Battle of Midway, when all of our valiant brave hearts gave the ultimate sacrifice for liberty, they were not only with our founding fathers in 1776, they were, in the words of the motto of Young Americans for Freedom, passing on the torch of freedom. Now, I understand that this is not an external war, young people, and God forbid that any of you have to be in harm's way and give the ultimate sacrifice, but there is a war nonetheless. It's an eternal war within the land. And thereafter, your heart and soul. And Ronald Reagan, on July 3rd, 1986, at the 100th anniversary of the Statue of Liberty, with the Statue of Liberty behind him, said these words, and I want to leave you with this. We are the keepers of the flame of liberty. We hold it high for the world to see. It is a light unto the nations. Let's pray that that lamp is never extinguished. Never extinguished. On the top of the Liberty Bell, from the book of Leviticus, chapter 25, verse 10, it says, proclaim liberty throughout the land and unto all the inhabitants thereof. Go forth, young Americans, and proclaim liberty throughout the land and fight for the flame of freedom in America. It's our calling. It's our job. Thank you very much. God bless.
We are going to open up Q&A as usual. Students, if you have a question, please line along the wall here. And supporters, if you have a question, please raise your hand, and my colleague Carrie Lee will come and find you with the microphone. Thank you.
All right. First of all, thank you, Dr. Jacobs, for that excellent speech.
Thank you.
I'm Anthony from Ursinus College, just outside of Philadelphia. I'll say, go Pack, go. We are going to the Super Bowl.
Love you already.
You mentioned a lot about Christian civilization and you know, prominent Christians in American history. And for those who may not know, just recently, Kanye West released an album entitled Jesus is King in all capital letters. He's also on the front cover of the latest issue of National Review, headline, Defender of the Faith, ? So I just wanted to ask you your thoughts on his rather public conversion, and if you think this is an example of God at work. You've mentioned, you know, how God works in mysterious ways.
Yeah. I'm always suspect at first, because you never know what could be going on, and God knows the heart. But it appears to me to be an authentic conversion. I mean, my heart was changed many, many years ago in my wild, crazy days. I understand what that means. Even George Wallace, segregationist, I say segregation now, tomorrow, and forever, he had an amazing conversion latter part of his life and asked literally thousands of African Americans to forgive him for the things that he had said back in the day. So I believe it is authentic, and I believe he can be used powerfully in the culture today.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hi.
My name's Amy. I go to Regent University. So how do you respond to, you know, far lefts and non-believers that say the government should not be based on Christian beliefs and that we are not a theocracy for that reason?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. Look, as I write my PhD dissertation, I call it Christian principles. This is not a theocracy. I don't want the president or the governor telling me how to worship and how to believe. But it's undeniable historical fact that in that time frame in American history, the overwhelming of our founding fathers were Christian, came from various denominations, Presbyterian, Congregationalist, Lutheran, a few Catholics in there, and they worked from that paradigm, from that premise that there was a God. And it's a very complicated, multi-layered question to answer shortly, but to me, let me give you a quick example. When they say that somehow there was this profound wall of separation of church and state, even William Rehnquist, the Supreme Court Chief Justice, said it was bad history. It was a bad metaphor. He said that ultimately the nation was founded on Christian principles, Christian guidelines. Even if you read John Locke's on government or Christianity. His books on Christianity. In fact, he wrote more books on Christianity. People don't know that. And he starts out in the book of Genesis with Adam and Eve, and he works his way through talking about the family as a form of government. And he develops, unfolds the social contract, and Christianity permeates throughout his works. But the example I wanted to give was when they actually ratified or passed the Constitution, President Washington in our very first Congress, they actually created a past a Thanksgiving proclamation that if you read the language, and you can find this in the Library of Congress, it permeates with Christian language. Even John Adams in his Thanksgiving proclamation a few years later does the same thing. And if you go into the Library of Congress, religion and early American history, you'll find just a preponderance of historical evidence that show that it did play a strong role. But nobody's asking the government to dictate to us. That's a big different. That's a totally different story. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Amy.
So this will be our final question, and actually I get to ask it. So I'm Madison Haversetzer again, and as we mentioned earlier, I studied secondary education, and I know we have some other potential teachers in the room, and I was wondering what advice you have for aspiring Christian conservative teachers working in public school.
Whoa. Look, my file at the old public school where I taught, I was in the teacher's office more than most of my students. Seriously. And I simply would, the things I would say here, the boss would say, are you talking about this from the founding fathers? Are you talking about that? You cannot read Abraham Lincoln, especially the latter part of his life, and not see God talk and not see God language. So the point is that there's such an overwhelming historical evidence of the conservative Christian ideas that a good teacher should, and I've had people say, "Oh, wow, what an amazing thing you've done." I go, "No, really, not. If you teach American history properly, then you should be able to pull these things out, Library of Congress, many other sources, and just teach these to the kids." I show them in the headline of the invasion of France, right there in one of the sub-headlines, is FDR calling for prayer in the nation, Harry S. Truman calling for prayer in the nation. There's nothing wrong with that. That's historical evidence. You can see it all throughout our history. You cannot have the American Revolution without the Great Awakening. You don't even really have the backdrop to the Civil War without the Second Great Awakening in this nation. All historical facts. I always say to my students, HC destroys PC. HD is historical context, historical correctness over the politically correct stuff that doesn't want the truths that we understand to be taught to our young people. So young teachers out there, go for it. If you ever need any advice, you just get a hold of me, and I'll help you out.
Let's give Dr. Jacobs another round of applause.
Thanks, Ron.
I remember as a student sitting, I believe it was a Milwaukee conference, I think back in 2012, I was in the audience, and I remember this is the first time I met Dr. J, and I tweeted back when I used to use Twitter, I wish our president loved America as much as Dr. Jacobs does. And I think that rings especially true. That was back under President Obama, for those of you who just needed some historical context there. So just a few quick announcements. Students, we're going to be heading up to the ranch right after this, so please, you'll head out the doors to go to the shuttles, which are going to be stationed outside to the right as you exit the front door. We have about a 45-minute drive ahead of us, so please feel free to quickly stop by the restrooms before we leave. Also, just note that the drive up to the ranch is a bit windy, so you just ate lunch, just keep that in mind. Supporters, we have some exciting sessions for you this afternoon that will take place in the classroom on the second floor. So you have a few minutes before those sessions start to check out our new exhibits in the gallery. So if you've been with us before, you'll notice that the new timeline table has been replaced. And so you'll get to enjoy exploring the revised and expanded versions of the timeline exhibit. I encourage you all to check that out. Also, on the third floor is a very special exhibit featuring the collection of our dear friend, United States Secret Service Agent John Barletta. Many of you have met John over the years, and you will enjoy seeing this new exhibit put together in his honor. So with that, thank you so much, and enjoy the rest of the afternoon.